Hello, and thank you for joining us today. I am your host, Alex Nazar, and welcome to the webinar, Introduction to Quantitative Accelerated Life Testing Analysis. Before we begin our presentation, I would like to review a few housekeeping items with you. Please take a moment to observe the tools available in the WebEx event window. Questions may be answered in the Q&A panel at any time and will be addressed at the end of the webinar. For technical support or other questions, please contact me using the chat panel. As this session concludes, please notice that a survey will appear in your browser. You can use this form to request a copy of the presentation, ask additional questions of our presenter, or provide us with feedback on what you learned today. I would now like to welcome HBM Prensia Application Engineer Daniel Cruz to begin his presentation. Daniel?
Thank you. So as Alex just mentioned, my name is Daniel Cruz, and I'm an application engineer here at HBM Prensia. So before we get into the topic, which is an introduction to quantitative accelerated life testing analysis, I'm just going to give a brief overview of what HBM Prensia is and what we do. So we are an umbrella brand for our two software brands, ENCODE and ReliaSoft. So ENCODE is sort of the digital signal processing, strain gauge and accelerometer data analysis and fatigue analysis side of things, whereas ReliaSoft has a host of tools for different kinds of reliability analyses. And we offer the softwares as well as training for the softwares and the theory and practice behind them. On top of that, we also offer engineering services, sometimes material testing, that kind of thing as well. So the softwares that we have available are on the left side and in the leftmost column, the ReliaSoft tools that are focused on data analysis, so times to failure data, initial reliability prediction, system reliability modeling, reliability growth analysis, and so on. In the middle column, we've got our reliability management tools, so analyses like FMEA, things for failure reporting and corrective action system. And we have SEP, which is sort of our web-based dashboard reporting tool. And on the right side, we've got the ENCODE suite of products. So Design Life, for example, is can take your CAE results and give you a fatigue life estimate, whereas GlyphWorks can do that sensor data analysis and come up with test specifications and fatigue predictions as well. So this webinar, we're going to be focusing specifically on ALTA, which is for accelerated life testing analysis. So just to give you a brief overview of what we're going to talk about, first we have to give kind of a brief summary or a brief recap of what life data analysis or WIBLE analysis is. That's kind of a fundamental part of accelerated life testing analysis, so it'll be good to review that. Then we're going to introduce the sort of need for and benefits of quantitative accelerated life testing, or as we call it, QALT. We're going to show how that analysis is done, how those results are calculated and what results you can get out of it, how that can be applied to intelligently design your accelerated tests, and a couple other things that it can be used for, so accelerated degradation analysis, analyzing use profiles, that kind of thing. Then at the end, we're going to have a software demonstration where we go through a simple use case in ALTA. So again, to start it off, we're going to do a brief review of life data analysis. And life data analysis is just trying to answer a number of questions, but at the simplest level, trying to answer the question for a part, how long is that part going to last? So if you buy a light bulb, you'll see on the box of the light bulb, in this case, a lifetime of 30,000 hours. So we have a number there that says how long that's going to last, in this case, 30,000 hours. Whether that's the best method, we'll see in a bit, but there may be other questions that we want to answer about a particular product as well. For example, how many parts will fail? Let's say we've got a certain number of sales that we're expecting, and we want to know how many of those will fail. That's something we can answer with life data analysis. We can compare populations. So we could look at a light bulb from two different suppliers, for example, and see is light bulb A or part A better than part B by doing this kind of statistical analysis. We can even look at sort of the behavior, the failure behavior rather than just sort of the lifetime and come up with some idea of whether we're observing different failure modes. So these are the kinds of questions that we're trying to answer with life data analysis, and that feeds in a little bit later into accelerated life testing analysis. So how this actually works is we test several components under normal sort of nominal conditions. So in this case, light bulbs. On the bottom, we've got a timeline where we tested 9 light bulbs, and we recorded the time at which each bulb failed. And then we've got a set of data that basically says, for this light bulb, we had 9. These are their failure times. And important to note with this type of analysis is that you want to separate different populations if you can, meaning that if you've got bulb A versus bulb B and they fail in different ways, you'd want to have them separate so that you can get good quality results. So once we've got these times to failure data, we might be tempted to, like the manufacturers of that bulb in that box that we saw earlier, just calculate the mean and report that. So that's easy to calculate, but can sometimes be not the best metric. If someone buys that bulb and they see 30,000 hours, obviously not every bulb is going to last exactly 30,000 hours. And it might even be misleading as to what percentage of bulbs would fail by that time. It could be 20%, it could be 80%, depending on how skewed our life distribution is to the left or to the right. And by life distribution, I mean what you see in the picture here, which is basically we take those failure times, 9 or in this case more failure times, and we split them into bins and fit a distribution. So the bins are in red. We split it up into 200-hour bins, and then we fit this distribution with that blue line. And once we've got that distribution, we've fully characterized the reliability of our light bulb in this example, and we can answer all of those questions that were of interest to us. We can look at sort of the area under the curve and answer a question, how many will fail in this period? How long will 50% of the population last for? Is A better than B? By looking at sort of the probability of one distribution being higher than another, we can look at the parameters of this distribution and answer the question, are there different failure modes? We can look at the uncertainty in those parameters and give confidence bounds on all of those estimates that we want. So that's what life data analysis is, and that's great, but today's products are typically very reliable or are expected to be very reliable, and that's a good thing. That's something that we've worked for many years to make our products more reliable. However, that could sometimes result in something like you see on the right side there, which is a timeline where we tested 20 samples for up to 500 hours, and by the end of our test, we've only observed one failure. So one failure is not enough to fit that distribution and answer those reliability questions. One potential solution to this problem would be to simply run the test for a very long time. However, modern design cycles are very short, typically, or at least short relative to the long product life that customers now expect. So this isn't really a viable option. We don't have that time to test products for that long. So another alternative would be to test lots and lots of samples. So we've already tested 20, which is, in many cases, more than is afforded to us for reliability testing. And getting much more than that would allow us to fit a failure distribution, but is very expensive. So we have sort of this conundrum where getting results faster would save us a lot of money by not requiring so much time for testing or not requiring so many samples. And this is sort of where we introduce quantitative accelerated life testing. So the idea behind accelerated testing in general is that we can make a test faster, we can make failures occur faster by increasing the stress. So on the right side again, we've got that same timeline, but this time with all 20 parts having failed by about 250 hours. And we've done that just by increasing the stress. And important to note is that when I say stress here, I don't mean just mechanical stress, megapascals or KSI or something like that, but any accelerating factor. So that could be something like temperature or humidity. So imagine that these parts are failing because they rust. Increasing the temperature or increasing the humidity would make them fail faster. Could be mechanical stress, could be something like voltage or current as well. But when we say stress, we just mean an accelerating factor here. So this is great. We've got results faster. We can fit a distribution, but there's some challenges in translating that into usable reliability results, and that's kind of what we'll talk about, those challenges and how ALTA can help you address them. But before we get into that too much, I just kind of want to give a brief clarification as to HALT versus QALT. So accelerated testing as a term is often used to refer also to highly accelerated life testing. And highly accelerated life testing uses typically similar or the same equipment as quantitative accelerated life testing. So in the upper right, you might have a shaker table or some sort of vibration testing equipment. In the bottom right, you might have a temperature humidity chamber. And in both of these, you might perform either a HALT or a QALT test, which is where the confusion sort of comes from. And the distinction here is that HALT testing is typically done to find and correct design weaknesses, as well as to understand the operating limits of a part. So that might look like in the upper right, where we've got that sort of circuit board, we might increase the vibration until we get an intermittent failure, note down what vibration level caused that intermittent failure, continue to increase the stress until it permanently fails, and then see what failed and note, okay, we can reinforce this component and make it a little bit more robust. So the objective there is to find something that you can improve with your design, as well as characterize the upper and lower limits of your design. QALT, on the other hand, is done the explicit goal of calculating reliability. So answering those same life data analysis questions, how many parts will fail, how long will the part last, and so on. So when we do that, we have typically very deliberately chosen stress levels to try and minimize uncertainty in our desired answer. So the key thing from this slide is that there's different objectives between these two analysis procedures. And that means that we've got different test methodologies that we go through and therefore different results. So if we take a HALT test where we've kind of increased the stress until we get a qualitative result that is useful to us, it's going to be very difficult to calculate a reliability figure from that. And even if we do, our uncertainty will be very high. So that's a question that we get very often is, can I calculate reliability from my HALT results? And the answer is you can, but it's not intended for that, and a QALT test is typically going to give you a better reliability estimate. So with that in mind, let's talk about some of the constraints that QALT testing has. So one of the first things we have to think about is that we should analyze one failure mode at a time. What I mean by that is that we might have a component that fails due to either fatigue or corrosion, for example. If we increase the temperature, that will likely make corrosion occur faster and have no impact on fatigue. Whereas if we increase the vibration level, that will likely make fatigue occur faster and have no impact on corrosion, for example. The idea being that it's difficult to appropriately accelerate multiple failure modes within one test. So to get a good result, to get a good reliability estimate, we typically want to look at one failure mode at a time. And we also want to choose multiple stress levels within the stress limits. So if you look at the right side here, every component or every product has some point at which for that stress of interest, so let's say it's temperature, it will be immediately destroyed, right? Let's imagine we've got a plastic component. Beyond a certain temperature, that plastic component is going to melt, right? So we need to pick stress levels that are representative of what happens at the use condition. Additionally, we need to choose multiple stress levels so that we can understand how life changes with stress. That's really what we're trying to do here. Related to that is also we need to understand the physics of the failure mode. We need to, even though we're going to have two or three stress levels to which we can fit some sort of relationship between life and stress, we need to know what form that relationship will have, because two or three points is not really enough to give us good statistical measures of fit. So what actually impacts the quality of the analysis? Well, on the right side is what we call the life stress relationship plot. And you can see these sort of sideways PDFs that represent failed samples at different levels of stress, in this case temperature. And the middle green line is representative of a life characteristic of our product. And what we're doing is we're taking those failures, those PDFs at high stress, and we're projecting them, we're extrapolating to low stress or to our use stress condition. Something to keep in mind here is that we're balancing how many failures we get with how far those failures are from our desired level of stress, from our use condition. So we kind of need to balance these factors, and that means that coming up with a test or designing a test requires careful consideration in the selection of those levels. And ALTA has a couple tools to help with that, and we'll talk about that in two sections. So now we're going to talk about how the analysis actually works, right? We know that there is a life stress relationship. What does that actually mean, right? So we have failures in an accelerated test at a high stress level, at a high temperature or at a high voltage or whatever, and we need to characterize how that is going to translate to the use stress level. So in the picture, we've got a couple of proposed squiggly lines, one that looks more squiggly than the others, one that's a line, one that's sort of an exponential relationship, and the idea is that we can take a high stress level, a medium stress level, and so on, and fit a relationship to those points so that we can come up with an estimate for the life distribution at the use stress. Once we've got that life distribution at the use stress, we can answer all of those reliability questions once again. So ALTA has a wide variety of life stress relationships that we can fit to our data. And to just review a couple of those and why it's important to choose the right one, we'll look at two examples here. So it's very important to choose a life stress relationship based on the physics of failure of your failure mode. And the reason for that is if you look at the picture and sort of the highlighted area, we might have very, very good statistical fit to our two or three stress levels for a whole bunch of life stress relationships. So to differentiate between them, we have to kind of use our engineering judgment. Two very common ones are the Arrhenius relationship and the power law relationship, or inverse power law relationship. And the Arrhenius relationship is based off of the Arrhenius reaction rate equation. And that is an equation that's an empirical fit to that relates the speed of a chemical reaction, or the reaction rate, to temperature. So that's especially appropriate if you have a failure mode that is a chemical reaction that's accelerated by temperature. Something like corrosion or material degradation of a plastic of some kind, right? And in general, we say thermally accelerated failures can often be modeled by an Arrhenius relationship. On the other hand, if we have something that follows an inverse power law form of relationship, so something like fatigue, high cycle fatigue follows a form that's similar to the inverse power law, or other non-thermal accelerating stresses tend to follow this type of relationship, that's the life stress relationship we would choose. And the reason that we need to choose this based on the failure mode is, again, because as we look to the left, they start to diverge a little bit. And whether they diverge in the correct way is determined by whether it accurately represents the physics of what's going on. Naturally, for different physical relationships, for different failure modes, there are other LSRs that we might want to use or that we can actually even define in the software. So on the right side, some of the bigger, scarier names that we've got there, you know, electromigration or radiation hardening or something like that. We have a variety of other life stress relationships which can handle combinations of stresses, interaction terms, categorical stresses, like we'll talk about in a bit, or even user-defined life stress relationships. And again, we have to pick this based on the physics of failure. So let's say we had an electromigration type failure mode, and based on a literature search, we determined that it follows Black's law, where the failure is accelerated by current density. We could then have our stress be current density, and we could define a formula that is in the same form as Black's law, and then use that as our life stress relationship. So using these and using our engineering judgment, we can account for multiple stresses, we can account for different life stress relationships, and so on. So after we've done this, we can calculate an acceleration factor between two stresses. And to put that another way, we now have reliability results in sort of this 3D surface. So if you've seen the a typical reliability versus time plot, this is essentially the 3D version of that. We've got reliability versus time versus temperature. And so at any given temperature, we can come up with our reliability versus time plot and come up with all of our results of interest. So something to keep in mind here is that the reason we're doing this methodology in the first place is because we would have had very few failures and therefore very high uncertainty, and we reduced that uncertainty by doing this methodology, but there's still higher uncertainty than you might be used to with this type of result. And so that means that it's even more important than normal to report confidence intervals on your reliability results of interest. And that's something that the software can help you do using a variety of different methods. So now we're going to talk about how this knowledge of the analysis and how it works can be applied to test design, to quantitative accelerated life test design. So the key problem here, as we've touched on, is that we have to balance the number of failures and the distance of those failures to the use condition, and that's not always immediately obvious. And if we do this kind of haphazardly and just pick high stresses to ensure failures or low stresses to ensure low extrapolation uncertainty, then we typically won't get an optimal result. So you might have a temperature humidity chamber like on the right, and you've got your samples in it, and you want to know how many samples should I put in there at once, and at what temperature and what humidity should I set it to. And ALTA has a couple statistical methods that we can use to plan those tests. And this basically works by estimating what our life distribution and what our LSR is. So we have those sideways PDFs. We have the middle green line, which is sort of our middle estimate, and the top and bottom, which are our confidence bounds, and we want to kind of shrink those confidence bounds at our use condition, at that red bar. So we can use several different schemes to come up with an optimal test design, or an optimal test design with several constraints, and by doing that, we can kind of shift those PDFs around and shrink those bounds. So as you can see, that red bar, we have wider bounds, and then we can have narrower bounds if we shift them in an appropriate way. The way that that works in ALTA is simply by inputting some information, right? So we need to say, what scheme do we want to follow? What are our test conditions? How much time do we have, and how many samples? And you can see what this might look like on the bottom there, and we'll see this in the software example as well. And ALTA is going to tell us, what are the stress levels, and how many samples should I test at each stress level according to variety of different schemes that are available. So a couple other things that we can do with this methodology. Won't get into too much detail, but some nice features if this is something that's relevant to you. Categorical stresses is one of those things. So there might be times when our stress is not strictly quantifiable, right, where we can have a non-quantifiable or a qualitative stress, and we can still analyze that with the same methodology, using particular life stress relationships. So this might be useful if we want to compare populations, or if we want to see how much the failure is accelerated between populations. So on the right side, you might have a test that you run on an engine, or a duty cycle that you run on an engine, that based on some historical knowledge, you expect to be about 10 times more damaging than laps around the track. You might have different customers or different customer groups or different use conditions, and you want to compare how much more accelerated failure is in use condition A versus B. Or you might have different regions, let's say Arizona and Michigan. You want to see, is there a failure acceleration between Arizona and Michigan? So this can kind of verify a lot of assumptions that you might make during testing. So instead of saying, yeah, we think that this duty cycle is about 10 times as damaging, you can say it's somewhere between 9 and 14 times as damaging, for example. Another kind of neat application of this is for mission profiles or time-varying stresses. So in many situations, we don't have a constant use stress. We don't have a single temperature that our product is always operating at, or a single current level or stress level that our product's always operating at. And so what we can do is describe the mission profile or the use level as a function of time in the software, and we can still come up with a life estimate given that mission profile. So let's say we've got In this case, I believe it's temperature versus time. We can then see how many repeats of that cycle would we survive according to our test data. And the way that this works is basically by adding up the damage accumulated at each stress level. So we accumulate damage very quickly at high stress and very slowly at low stress, and then we can see, okay, at this particular time, we've endured these stresses and therefore have this much damage, and this is our probability of failure. So this is something that can be nice to use in cases where you've got a profile like that. An additional thing that can be useful is degradation analysis. So for certain types of failures, we can measure a degrading quantity. We can measure, so a classic example is tire tread depth or LED brightness. So for tires, there's a certain level of depth beyond which the tire is considered failed, or to a certain level of shallowness, I should say, rather. And you can measure the tire tread depth over time, and based on a fitted model, you can project when that tire will no longer be acceptable. For LEDs, for example, the brightness declines until they reach some critical level and fail, so you could measure the brightness of an LED, project when that LED will fail. And by projecting those failure times, we can fit a life distribution. So on the right side, you can see for several units, we've fit a degradation model, we've projected a failure time, and based on that failure time, or based on those projected failure times, we've come up with a life distribution. And we can actually combine this methodology with accelerated testing for those cases where neither just degradation analysis nor just accelerated life testing analysis can yield results quickly enough. Okay, so we've covered a lot of stuff, and we're going to go into now a brief software demonstration of sort of a simple case in ALTA. So the idea here is that we manufacture a defibrillator, which is used in an ambulance, so that green little box in the picture on the right. And for this defibrillator, the failure mode is driven by road vibration. So this thing sits on the wall of an ambulance and has to be used every once in a while, and the thing that drives failure is the vibration from the road that rattles around some stuff in the box. And our customers, so the people who are buying this and installing it in ambulances, hospitals, or whatever, have decided that this needs to be 95% reliable at a 90% lower bound confidence level at 5 years of use. So one way to phrase that that's very common is R95, C90 at 5 years. And they've also determined that 5 years is about equivalent to 500 hours of shaker table time at our use level of road vibration, which we'll measure in GRMS. So currently, to meet this reliability specification, we have to run a reliability demonstration test where we take a bunch of these, vibrate them, and if none of them fail after a particular time, we say that reliability specification has been met. And this currently takes at least 700 hours with the number of samples that we have. So that's a really long time. And we are interested in using ALTA to design and analyze an accelerated test to try and shorten that time. So I'm going to go ahead into the software now. And the first thing that we'll see here is the demonstration test. So this is actually a Weibull folio, but you can see that we've indicated suspensions, so 12 suspensions at 700 hours. And all that means is that at the end of 700 hours, all 12 of these units were still operating, and in this case, that's enough to demonstrate our R95 C90 specification. And we wanted to go down from the 700 hours. So what we did is we went to our test planning tool, so our ALTA test planning tool that we saw earlier on. And this basically allows us to say, I want to build a 4-2-1 plan, for example. 4-2-1 plan is a plan where you have for every 4 units at the low stress level, you have 2 units at a medium stress level and 1 unit at a high stress level. I'm putting in what metric I'm trying to calculate. In other words, what metric I'm trying to minimize the uncertainty about, how much test time I have and how many samples, some information about the life distribution, some information about the life stress relationship. So in this case, because I've got a vibration type stress, I'm assuming that it follows a power or inverse power law life stress relationship. And this information is kind of a high level estimate because you can't really know this beforehand. but you can have some idea of how many failures you expect at your maximum stress or at your use stress, and some idea of how whether the failure behavior is increasing or decreasing, and so on. And so what we do is we generate a test plan, and then ALTA tells us, okay, your low stress level should be 0.33 GRMS, your medium stress level should be 0.5, and your high should be 0.75. Accordingly, you should test about 7 samples, about 3 samples, and about 2 samples at those different stress levels. So based on some information that we gave it, based on a test plan scheme that we chose, it's telling us what stress levels we should test at and how many samples we should test at each stress level to minimize the uncertainty in our desired estimate. So we went ahead and gave that information to our test group, who ran an accelerated test for us. So we have our 2 samples in this column that indicates the stress. We have our 2 samples at 0.75 GRMS. We have 3 samples at 0.5 and 7 samples at 0.33. And you can see that we saw more failures at 0.75, 1 failure at 0.5, and no failures actually at 0.33. And we actually stopped the test at 300 hours, and we'll see why in a little bit. So all that we have to do is, once we've input our data, pick the appropriate model, in this case an inverse power law Weibull model, and then we can start to look at all of our different results. So we can look at, for example, our life stress relationship plot, and let me just reset that. And this is sort of those sideways PDFs for our different stress levels, as well as that life characteristic, and I have this nice interactive plot where I can drag along and see what my Weibull scale parameter is going to be at different stress levels. I can look at my reliability versus time plot, since that was actually of interest to me, and I've actually defined my target reliability to show up on this plot. And I can see that that's well below my 50th percentile estimate. However, I can even throw confidence bounds on this plot. I can throw a one-sided lower 90% confidence bound on this plot and change the scaling so that I can see whether I'm actually meeting my reliability target. And I can see that, yes, I am. I have, within 300 hours instead of 700 hours, met my reliability target, my R95C90 reliability target. And all of these plots are nicely interactive and can be copy and pasted and put into PowerPoint or Word or an email or whatever you may want to. And on top of that, to further quantify that, we can go into QCP, which is our quick calculation pad that lets us calculate results, all of those reliability metrics that are of interest to us, based on our input. So I can say that my stress is 0.1 GRMS. At 500 hours, I want my one-sided lower confidence bound on reliability, and I can see that that is 96.6%. So I've demonstrated 96.6% reliability at a 90% lower confidence level in only 300 hours for the time of 500 hours. Okay, so there's a lot of stuff to help us as analysts answer these questions and understand that we've met the spec. We can, of course, copy-paste those plots. We also have a tool to make a report here. So if I double-click this, I get a report window that comes up here. And this is basically a spreadsheet-style, kind of Excel-style report where I can say, I can point to my actual data source or my actual analysis that I've done. So here, for example, I'm reporting the median life based on my default data source as well as some cells in this spreadsheet. And what this means is that this is a nice reproducible, portable report, right? So I can do the analysis multiple times and generate results that are of interest to me in exactly the same way. And this is kind of the canned one that comes with the install, but you can configure your own. And I've actually configured my own sort of Word document style report here as well, where I've said I want a table that shows me my reliability bounds from 100 hours to 500 hours at 90% confidence level. I want to see my model parameter bounds, as well as a couple standard plots for life versus stress, residual plot, and my uncertainty with stress. And all that I have to do for any of these reports is tell it which data source I want it to pull from. So in this case, that 421 plan 300-hour test, tell it what U stress I want to calculate these results based on. And then I can actually just see a quick preview of this. And I've got those tables generated based on this result. I've got those plots. And I could send this to Word or send this to a PDF. So this is a really nice feature to take that analysis and report results of interest in a reproducible and easily palatable way. Okay, so just to summarize, ALTA helped us intelligently plan our accelerated test, helped us choose what stress levels to test at and how many samples and how long to test for, and it let us calculate metrics of interest based on those test results. And so the result of that is that our demonstration test that we were doing before that used to take 700 hours to show R95C90 now only takes 300 hours. So we met our reliability specification in less than half the time thanks to using ALTA, thanks to using accelerated life testing methodology. So with that, I'll open it up to questions.
Thank you, Daniel. As a reminder, please use the Q&A panel to ask your questions, and they will be answered in turn.
Okay, we've got one here. I have to make the window a little bit larger. Okay, so here's one that says, question on QALT. While running the QALT, how do we approach it if there's a failure observed that has no relation with the stress being accelerated? For example, we see a random failure when we are accelerating temperature, and the failure has no temperature relation. That's a very good question. So in the event that you see a failure that is not of interest to you for that analysis, you can consider it a suspension. So let's say that you've got in the example that I gave, a corrosion and a fatigue-type failure mode. If while you're analyzing the fatigue-type failure mode, you see a corrosion failure, you can consider that a suspension for the reason that it did not fail due to fatigue, right? And you essentially took it out of the fatigue test at that time. So you can consider it a suspension. That applies not just to ALTA methodology, but also to regular old life data analysis. Another question here is, can ALTA select the best power law to apply? So I think that you're talking about the life stress relationship. And yes, we have a tool that compares the statistical fit for different life stress relationships. However, something to note there is that we've got usually two or three stress levels that we're fitting to. So if you've got two or three points, the statistical fit is not going to be a super robust way to consider which one is the best. So it should generally be based on the physics of failure. The general rule of thumb that we gave earlier with Arrhenius for thermally accelerated failures and inverse power law for non-thermally accelerated failures is just that, very general. But you can do a literature search for your failure mode of interest. I gave the example of electromigration and come up with the appropriate life stress relationship. In the absence of that, we have that rule of thumb and those measures of statistical fit. We had another question that said, how many failures are desired at each stress level? That's the thing is, with test design, we don't actually want, we don't strictly say we want this number of failures at each stress level. There's lots of rules of thumb that you can find that say you should have no failures or one failure at the low stress level and all failures at the high stress level or something like that. But really, the test design tool kind of makes that pretty nice to handle because you can say, I don't have to think explicitly about the number of failures at each stress level, but I can rather think about the results that I'm trying to get and then pick my stress levels and the expectation of failure accordingly. What are some limitations to the QALT analysis approach? So I had a slide on that earlier. You need to know some stuff about the physics of failure. You have to analyze one failure mode at a time, right? There's a little bit of prior knowledge that has to go into that. So if you're used to perhaps highly accelerated life testing, that typically has less information going in and gets sort of qualitative results. And some of those qualitative results can be used to effectively do a QALT test, right? So One of the limitations I would say is that you need to have some information to do it or to get good results out of it. We have another question. Is a part treated as a suspension for a type of failure mode when it experienced a different failure mode? Yes, someone asked that earlier. Yes, you can consider it as a suspension. Someone said, tire tread depth should not include 0 miles as initially high failure rate occurs. And an example of this could include wear out of mold flash at the edges of the tread. Yes, so tires in particular, they follow sort of a two different relationships. Early on, they follow a faster wear pattern, and then as they kind of break in, they follow a slower wear pattern. So that's something that you should be aware of if you're doing a degradation analysis, is what relationship does this actually follow? Because, again, you're making kind of an extrapolation. The difference there is that we typically have a lot more points to fit a degradation model to. Like, we might take, you know, 10 or 20 measurements, and we have a lot better idea of what's going on based on 10 or 20 measurements than 2 or 3 in the case of a life stress relationship. Can you show again how you determine the accelerated test should be suspended at 300 hours? So you could, while you're running your accelerated test, every time you get a failure, or you know every set time interval, input your results in ALTA and calculate what's my lower bound reliability. And that's what someone was doing while this test was running, perhaps once a day. And they, after 300 hours, they said, okay, we've met our R95 C90 specification. There's no need to continue running this test. So given that this is something that happens over the span of a long period of time, it's worth doing that to make sure that you don't accidentally run for an additional 200 hours when you don't need to. Can you clarify what Weibull analysis is? Yes. So Weibull analysis is probably the more common name for life data analysis. And that is a way to basically fit a distribution to failure times, like I showed earlier. And the reason why you want to do that is to understand for a light bulb, for example, what percent will fail in the first 10,000 hours, right? That's the question that we can answer with Weibull analysis. And that's really useful as engineers, right? Because we might want to know how long should we set our warranty for if we only want 5% returns? Or how long will this part last so that we know how often we have to replace it, right? Those kinds of things can be answered with Weibull analysis. And how it works is just fitting a statistical distribution. So a normal distribution, but more commonly a Weibull distribution or a log normal distribution, right? Those are all distributions that we could fit to failure times and come up with those reliability estimates. How close do the initial estimates need to be when designing a test plan? That's an excellent question, and obviously as close as possible. So the if you knew all of that information beforehand, if you knew what the life stress relationship was and what the failure behavior was exactly, there would be no point in doing the test because that's information that you would get from the test, right? So what you want to do is you want to choose a test plan that kind of is robust to small changes in that, right? So if you're not very confident that you know what the life distribution is or that you know how many failures you'll expect at the maximum stress, you want to choose a test plan like the 421 plan, which is probably the most common plan, which is the one that I chose in the demonstration, that will be somewhat robust to a change. If you're off a little bit, it'll still get you a decent estimate. And then you can factor that into your next test plan, right? If you were off a little bit, then the next time when you put in that prior information, you can be a little bit more. Will this presentation be available for us to review later on? Yes, we're going to you're going to get the survey form after you exit the webinar, and I think there's a checkbox for you to check where you can get a copy of the slides. I think this is also going to be uploaded to our website after this webinar is over. What is the model to use for mechanical stress? So mechanical stress and megapascals, that typically will accelerate a failure mode that follows an inverse power law type relationship. However, that's not always the case. And as I said a couple times before, the model or the life stress relationship that you want to use should be based, we have those rules of thumb in the absence of more information, and that rule of thumb would say use IPL or inverse power law for mechanical stress. But it's always better to do a literature search and try and understand what the life stress relationship governing the physics of failure is. That'll typically give you better results. Another question is, do you always use inverse power law for ALT data analysis? No. So inverse power law is one of those many life stress relationships that you can use to model how your product's life or that failure mode's life changes with time. But we have lots in the software, and actually with the clever use of the general log linear life stress relationship, you can model life stress relationships from the literature. So you can say, you can transform the stresses and do some sort of clever calculations and model complex relationships for electromigration or radiation hardening or whatever. So you can use a whole variety of life stress relationships. Someone else said, how important is it to use literature or other expertise to inform stress model choice when you have little or no experience with testing? So it depends. If you have a failure mode that's well understood, odds are good that you can find somebody who's done something similar before and has a life stress relationship that they've characterized that you can use. So a lot of circuit board failure modes will be very, very well characterized, because a lot of accelerated life testing methodology came from that sort of engineering world. But in the absence of that's why we have those rules of thumb. And of course, if you get weird results, we have a couple diagnostic plots, residual plots, and so on, so that you can sort of validate your model. You can also learn from that experience, right? If you choose an Arrhenius relationship and then you see that doesn't fit at all, you can try an IPL, and you can investigate and see whether other people have done that or whether it made sense with the results of the test. How do you manage multi-stress tests? So you can, depending on the life stress relationship you choose, you can handle up to 8 simultaneous stresses in ALTA. However, I wouldn't recommend that because 8 simultaneous stresses is a lot, and it's a lot of stuff to manage in terms of uncertainty and projection, right? So those, again, coming from the HALT world, might be familiar with situations where you have lots and lots of stresses and you ramp them all up until failures occur. But we're trying to, in the case of QALT, hone in on one particular failure mode and one particular estimate. So you can definitely do that in the software. And we have, you might have noticed, the temperature-humidity relationship is basically a combined power law and, double Arrhenius. We have thermal, non-thermal, which is a combined Arrhenius and inverse power law. And then using general log linear, again, you could combine up to 8 stresses transformed in various ways. But I would be careful about the level of uncertainty that you're introducing into the projection by having lots and lots of stresses. So you can do it in the software, but as a rule of thumb, be careful. How can you determine the number of samples to demonstrate reliability with 0 failures? So we were talking about accelerated life testing or accelerated test planning. We also have a tool in Weibull to come up with a reliability demonstration test, which is what we saw at the beginning. So that basically works by using binomial probability. So observing, what's the probability of observing 0 failures, rather, in reverse, what's the probability of failure given that I've observed 0 failures at this time? And then it uses an assumed life distribution to project that out to a later time. So that's how that works, and we also have a tool that helps you do that in the same way in Weibull++. Can you please show an example of how to estimate acceleration factor based on two models, that is inverse power law and Arrhenius. So I won't show an example in this webinar because I've got a lot of questions to answer, but please fill out that survey and you can send me an email as well. We can talk about that. So inverse power law and Arrhenius would be the thermal, non-thermal life stress relationship in ALTA, and you would just have an additional column where you put in what's my thermal stress, what's my non-thermal stress, and so on. How do you take into account uncertainty of beta? So that's a very, very good question. So beta in a Weibull distribution is representative of failure behavior. And it's important to sort of validate your model that to ensure that beta is not changing significantly at different stress levels, because that might be an indication that you're introducing a different failure mode, that you've raised the stress too high and the part's melting, for example. So we actually have the ability to show a contour plot, which is a representation of the likelihood bounds of your model parameters. And you can do that for each stress level and see whether they're approximately the same beta. We have a chi-squared test that can look at the beta values for each stress level and see whether they're statistically significantly different. And we can print parameter bounds, as I did in the report that I generated, that show the reasonable ranges of beta. Another question here, how do you correlate reliability at normal stress levels with accelerated failure data? So that was what we were talking about. That's the life stress relationship, right? We take the accelerated failure data and we fit the life stress relationship to it and then project that to the normal stress level. Repeat question here. Someone else also asked, what's the minimum number of failures required? I think I answered that already. Could this be used to design accelerated tests for solder joint related failures? Have you ever applied it in this way? Yes, so for a lot of fatigue failures, accelerated testing methodology or accelerated life testing methodology is not the correct tool, because fatigue is something that's so well understood that you could have an EN curve, for example, that shows, you know, multiple failure modes and keeps track of that at the same time just by looking at strain amplitude, for example. For solder joints, as I understand, that's something that typically can't be measured or really calculated. So what people will do is they'll have like a vibration level for their part with solder joints, and they'll record how long it takes to fail at different vibration levels. And in that case, this would be, you know, an excellent methodology to apply. So yes, people do it, solder joint related failures and accelerated life testing methodology. Can ALTA be truncated at the number of failures rather than time? You can stop the test based on whatever criteria you want. I think the important thing is to keep track of what reliability metric you're trying to estimate and whether your test is giving you satisfactory result in that regard. Another question, how are multiple stresses and interactions between stresses calculated? So this again goes into the multiple stress thing. You can have interaction terms included in your life stress relationship. So let's say you've got temperature and stress range, right? Or temperature and vibration. You can have a temperature vibration interaction term included. And there's a couple different ways to do that in the software. Someone asked, can I quickly show again the calculator features where you calculate the number of test samples to use? We've got some. I want to make sure that I answer as many questions as possible because they keep coming in. But if you're interested in that, we have documentation online. You can send me an email after this or fill out the survey form, and I'll send you a tutorial on how that works. Or we can set up a call or a WebEx or something after the fact to go over. Is maximum likelihood to use to estimate the parameters when there are suspensions? Yes. For ALT analysis, we use maximum likelihood estimation for the reason that we're actually creating like a three-parameter model that is stress sensitive. So using least squares doesn't really make a lot of sense. So we always use a maximum likelihood when we're doing ALT analysis in the software. Is the power law used to scale the central parameter of the distribution, but is the variance parameter constant or scaled? We basically take our life distribution, so Weibull distribution, for example, and then we say our scale parameter, so eta in a Weibull distribution, is now a function of stress, and then we use maximum likelihood estimation to fit that. So the variance parameter, there isn't actually a variance parameter for Weibull distribution, but the shape parameter is assumed to be constant because that is consistent with the assumption that we're looking at one failure mode across all stress levels. If it's not constant, then that's an indication that we've got different failure mode.
I think we have time for like one more question.
Okay, I'll go over one more, and then please fill out the survey form and contact us if you've got additional questions. If we have, can ALTA be used when the presence of failures is checked at intervals, when you have interval data? Yes. Yes, you can do that. In the software, when you set up an ALTA folio, you can specify that I have interval type data. Okay. I think we're running out of time here, so Alex.
Yeah. I think that's about all the time we have for today. Thank you all so much for your questions and for joining us today. I hope you enjoyed the presentation. There will be a recording available on the website within 24 hours. And as Daniel mentioned, please fill out the post-event survey to ask any additional questions of our presenter. Please feel free to register for any of the upcoming webinars listed here. You can the complete list can be found on hbmprencia.com/webinars, as well as a number of training courses. I did see a couple of questions about that as well. If you are local to the area, the European User Group meeting is coming in this fall. Registration is currently open for the October 15th and 16th User Group meeting held in just outside of CDG Airport in Paris. So on behalf of Daniel and myself, thank you so much for joining us today. We look forward to your attendance on our next webinar, which will cover frequency domain fatigue analysis with ENCODE Design Life on September 4th. And if you have additional questions of our presenter, his email is listed here. Thank you again all for joining us. We hope you have a wonderful rest of the day wherever you are in the world, and we'll see you on our next webinar. Have a great day.